Carnegie Mellon and Duke University, fellow at Stanford Law School and UC Berkeley, and head of faculty at Singularity University. Welcome, Vivek.
Good morning to you. It's nighttime here where I'm in Silicon Valley. Should I start my presentation?
Vivek, even before that, I would like to add on to what, Sanjana, was it? Trisha said. It's my privilege to welcome Mr. Vivek Wadhwa. If I were to look back in the year 2009, Larry Ellison of Oracle rubbished the idea of cloud computing and reduced it to same old wine in a new bottle, just a repackaging of existing technologies. The CEO thundered nonsense to a crowd that cheered on. 7 years later, Oracle's cloud went live. Any company, large or small, could now avail of its database services without a server on its premises. Ellison was an astute leader, someone who knew how to set his opinions aside, make a critical course correction. Not everything is like that in the world of technology. You can contrast that with Intel. It still has a negligible presence on mobile devices after being the king of the empire of computing for decades. These days, every one of us carries computers. These are the cell phones that we carry along with us. They have tremendous power. Chips are made by companies such as Qualcomm and not Intel. So technology forecasting and planning can be a tricky affair. Andy Grove, who once headed Intel, said only the paranoid survive. Yeah, and that is true. So every society needs well-informed savants whose projections show innovators what they can expect of the road that lies ahead and what to aim for. So instead of making doomsday predictions, they offer the hope and promise for better days to come. It's always a positive twist. Mr. Vivek Wadhwa is a man with such a crystal ball whose statements have been spot on. We at IIM Bangalore are privileged to have him address the audience at Eximius. So, Trisha has already gone ahead with, the speaker's profile. One thing, he's a very prolific writer. His articles have appeared in the Washington Post, Bloomberg, Business Week, Forbes, long list, including Hindustan Times. He's also written on foreign policy. He's the author of the 2012 nonfiction book, The Immigrant Exodus, Why America is Losing the Global Race to Capture Entrepreneurial Talent. So he's here today to offer us his grand insights on the challenges that humanity faces and the role of technologies, especially in a context that is technology rich, such as Bangalore. So I'd like to make a correction here. He's going to be basically offering his insights on challenges of humanity, what things we can do to go ahead. Yeah. So I welcome Vivek Wadhwa. Thank you very much. Over to you, Vivek.
Thank you. Professor Shankar and I were talking earlier on, and I said that rather than talking about this bullshit Web3, let's talk about saving the world. Because if you read like the last Hindustan Times article I wrote, I was basically ripping into Web3, and I said what Silicon Valley has been dreaming about, what fantasizing about, India has already built with UPI, that just with nuts and bolts, it was able to deliver the big promise of Web3 itself. So in this talk, I'm going to discuss why all of you have opportunities to impact humanity in a big way. I'm going to tell you what's changed over the last two decades and why you can only dream what your parents dreamt of doing. Why you can do what your parents dreamt of doing. Because, even a decade ago, IIMs were really to churn out management consultants. Now, I think only the losers are going to join the management consulting ranks. The best of you are going to develop world-changing startups and impact humanity in a positive way. And yes, that's a snipe at the consulting companies who I don't hold in very high regard, because I think you should be thinking much bigger than joining a consulting company that's going to charge mega bucks to tell the customers what they want to hear. So let's not get off tangent here. Let's talk about now entrepreneurship in the era of exponential technologies. I hope you can see my screen. If not, someone yell at me. All right, let's see now if I can get my scroller working. All right. First of all, why do I say that you can build world-changing startups? Because the cost of starting a company has dropped exponentially. You know, today, all you need really is a laptop. And if you're building agriculture technologies, some sensors, I'm going to show you some of the technologies, but really almost anyone can access the most advanced development tools on the planet through a $500 computer. In my days, when I became an entrepreneur, it would cost millions of dollars to start a company. I founded two companies. The first one cost $20 million to start. The second one cost $33 million to start. Today, if I was starting a company here in Silicon Valley, I would need maybe $50,000, $100,000 to start a company. You can translate that into rupees and cut it into half. Because the cost of starting a company in Bangalore is even less than it is in Silicon Valley. This is what has changed. Why has it changed? Because of exponential technologies. This chart that's coming up here, I'm assuming you can see it, shows you how technology has been advancing. It took thousands of years to go from agriculture to pottery to the plow. Over the last 100 years, we have had advance after advance after advance. We do not understand exponentials. We learned the hard way during the pandemic what exponentials mean. Before the pandemic, I used to have to teach business executives and students what exponentials meant. Now everyone understands what's exponential and how, you know, viruses can catch you by surprise. Well, it is not only viruses that advance exponentially. It is everything that's information based. You know, as the professor was saying, these devices we carry in our hands right now are very powerful computers. My smartphone is more powerful than the Cray supercomputers of yesteryear that could not be imported into India. Now even the poorest of the poor in the world have smartphones. That's because information technologies keep doubling in their price, performance, capacity, and bandwidth every year or two. A year is a little bit aggressive. 1 to 2 years, you see a doubling in these factors. And we've seen this with computing. Over the last 120 years, we've seen the power of technologies go from being very crude to now being at a point that we carry 40 or 50 supercomputers in our pocket. That's how powerful these smartphones are. The same power as 40 or 50 supercomputers of the 1970s. This is how technology has been advancing. And it isn't just computing. It is everything that computing touches: AI, robotics, sensors, networks, digital medicine. All of these technologies that become information-based are advancing exponentially. This is the key thing you need to learn, that when any field of science becomes information-based, it starts advancing exponentially and magic things happen. All right, with this explanation, I'm going to now show you some of these basic advances and what they mean to us. First of all, sensors. The first digital camera was released in 1975. It cost $10,000. It weighed about 4 kilograms, and it was a whopping 0.01 megapixel. This is the first digital camera. What you have in your pockets today in your smartphones is about a billion times better, a billion-fold improvement in cameras over the last 30 or 40 years. You know, the United States used to have nuclear missiles, which were guided by ICBM navigation units. They used to cost tens of millions of dollars and they weighed 50 pounds in the 1960s. Today, what you have in your pockets in that smartphone that you have is about a billion times cheaper and better than what's in the American nuclear missiles of the 1960s. The gyroscopes and accelerometers cost practically nothing right now. The first global positioning system, GPS, was released in 1981. It cost $120,000 and weighed 53 pounds. Today, you can buy a GPS for less than a dollar on Alibaba. And the GPSs you get today are about 1,000 times more accurate than what you had before. What does this mean? That we can now build smart cities like what we dreamed about, where every aspect of a city's functioning is automated. Everything about your, whether it be your university campus, whether it be your village, whether it be your city, whether it be the country, everything about it can be monitored, and the data can be analyzed using artificial intelligence. The sensors cost practically nothing. This is a $1 trillion opportunity. This, you know, it's an opportunity for you to build $1 billion companies. All of you can now be building smart cities using these sensors, which are inexpensive. The next thing I'm going to show you is the advance of robots. Your parents may have watched a cartoon called Rosie the Robot. I don't know if any of you watched it because you're too young, but a lot of us grew up watching Rosie.
Hello, I'd like to rent a maid.
Rosie. I hope you can hear the sound.
Coming, sir. Here I am, sir. Here goes.
So we had Rosie.
R2?
And then we had R2-D2.
I am C-3PO Human Cyborg Relations. I beg your pardon, but what do you mean, naked? My parts are showing. My goodness.
All right, so these are the robots that my generation, that your professor's generation grew up watching. And we thought that when we grew up, we're going to have all of these robots serving us. We didn't get them. The most advanced robot that's available in the United States for home use is the Roomba. It's a vacuum cleaner. It's a joke. You know, the United States government has something called the DARPA challenge. That's a Defense Department challenge in which they offer millions of dollars prizes. So they had a robotics challenge. And in 2015, this is what the robotics challenge, what's the results of the robotics challenge were. These are the most advanced robots in America. All right, so this is the DARPA, the US government was so embarrassed about the DARPA challenge and about these clowns that they had showcased that they stopped doing the DARPA challenge. So as of a few years ago, we wrote off robots saying that they will never advance. All right, now I'm gonna take you to my university, Carnegie Mellon University, and show you the progression of robots. I'm gonna show you a series of videos which show you the exponential advance of these technologies. The first video shows you 20 years of progress. And then I'm going to show you 6 years of progress and 4 years of progress and show you how robots have been advancing. Again, I'm doing this to show you the exponential advance of technologies because you have to understand how fast things are changing. So now this is the Carnegie Mellon University Leg Lab and the progress they made over a 20-year period. They were very excited about it, but you know, when you look at it, it's a joke. So the scientists at Carnegie Mellon University left the university and started a company. They created a startup called Boston Dynamics. Watch what they achieved in 6 years now. Not bad, right? That's pretty decent progress for 6 years. Now watch what happened over the next 4 years. Again, think exponential. very good progress. Now watch what happened within 2 years. So 20 years, 6 years, 4 years, and 2 years of progress. Pretty darn good, right? Now, a side note over here. Please be good to the robots, because if you're not good to the robots, then they're going to have their revenge. I'm going to show you how. All right, now that was 2 years. Watch what happened 1 year later in 2018. Born free is free. This is progress. And now watch what happens. All right, Skynet is coming. And that's why you need to be good to your robots. Even if you have a Roomba, be nice to your Roomba. All right, now let's shift gears and talk about the future of medicine. All right, I'm going to show you how these technologies apply to different fields of science. So the point I'm going to make over here is that, you know, remember before in the lecture, I said that when anything becomes information-based, it starts advancing exponentially. Well, medicine is now information-based. It's advancing exponentially. Because if you now look at it, Apple is now in the business of selling medical devices. The Apple Watch is a medical device. The entire tech industry right now is entering the field of medicine because they see a multi-trillion dollar industry where they can may reap billions of dollars in profits. So Apple Watch, next step, we're gonna have epidermal electronics. We're gonna have band-aids on your skin, which means that you're connected 24/7. Data is going to be captured all the time from our bodies, which means that now we have massive amounts of data. Everything about our functioning, our mood, our lifestyle, our habits, our stress levels, fertility levels, our emotions, our sleep levels, everything is being recorded using these technologies. And I'm sure that you've learned the basics of artificial intelligence, machine learning, because when you have data, what you do with data is that you analyze it. So when we start analyzing all of these data, within the next 3 or 4 or 5 years, AI-based doctors are going to be more competent than human doctors are. AI in the next few years will exceed the capabilities of human doctors. Why? Because medicine is becoming digital. It is becoming an information technology. This is how everything is advancing. Okay, now I'm going to shift gears again. Now I'm going to tell you some of the basics about technology advances. Peter Diamandis has what he calls the 6Ds exponential framework. What he explains is that information first becomes digitized, then it becomes deceptive, disruptive, dematerializes, and then it demonetizes. This is complex. Let me show you exactly what democratizes. Let me show you what this means in much simpler terms. First of all, digitized. Well, all of these things, maps. I mean, your parents used to read paper maps. Now everything is on your smartphones. But in our era, in my era, we used to have books that we would read. We would have maps, paper maps. You still read books, I'm sure, but everything is now digitized. Everything is, even music. We used to have cassette tapes. Everything has now become digitized. Right? That's what's happening to all information. It is becoming digitized. And then it becomes deceptive and disruptive. This is an example of the first personal computer. When it was first released in the 1980s, even the New York Times was making fun of it. I mean, no one believed that these PCs were real. This is an op-ed from the New York Times of 1985. They were saying that, who would ever want to take a computer back home from the office with them? I mean, you know, if you read the comments that the New York Times made, when we look at it, it becomes a joke. This is what the New York Times said about computers. And then when the first iPhone came out in 2007, CNET was joking about its slow data quality, low memory requirements. I mean, it was just ridiculous that they were saying that, oh my God, you have to sync your phone with your computer to manage content. This CNET basically was making fun of the iPhone. It wasn't only CNET. The CEO of Microsoft in those days, Steve Ballmer, was saying that there's no chance that the iPhone is going to get any significant market share. This is how everyone discounts exponential technologies. Dematerialization. Well, all of these things now fit in your pockets. Many of you have not seen fax machines or VCRs or cassette players. Some of you have calculators. These are all just features on your smartphone now. These are just apps on your smartphone now. They dematerialized. Demonetization, well, everything has become digital now, right? That's the way the world works. I have what's called the Hall of Toast, where how everything becomes toast. LP records, I don't know if any of you have ever seen an LP record, but now we simply download our music from iTunes or other, or Savan or, you know, these downloading sites. Long distance. Before, 10, 20 years ago, this call that we're doing would have cost thousands of dollars and you would not have been able to access it. Now you're able to call anyone anywhere for practically nothing. Bookstores, there's still a few bookstores left in the world, but they're disappearing because everything has become digitized. There used to be a company called Blockbuster in America from which we rented videos. Well, now you simply go on Netflix and you get all the movies you want. Taxi cabs, Ola and Uber. Yes, I know there are lots of problems with Ola and Uber. We want our taxi cabs back, but that's a different story. Classifieds, all been digitized. This is how everything has become digital and how everything is advancing exponentially. What this means is that entire industries are about to be disrupted. You know, in my longer lectures, I go through industry after industry after industry. I can go through every industry from agriculture to telco and tell you how it's going to be disrupted. And when disruption happens, there are $1 trillion new industries being created and $1 billion opportunities. This is why I'm getting back to the message I started this lecture with, that rather than joining, crappy old management consulting company, God forbid, or even one of these big Indian conglomerates, you should think about starting a company and saving the world. Why? Because you can. Because the skills that you've gained at IIM have given you the ability to bring together really bright people and to build world-changing startups. Because we have a lot of problems in the world now. We have to save humanity. That we are in deep trouble. That the world is falling apart in many ways, and there are lots and lots and lots of problems. But I'm going to give you some good news here. I'm going to show you some examples of how we're literally going to solve the grand challenges of humanity, how we're literally going to save this planet. I sound very ambitious, don't I? Let's start with energy. In parts of India, in large parts of Africa, when children come home, they can't study because they don't have electricity, right? Energy is something which is destroying this planet. We're fighting wars over energy. Right now, energy prices have shot through the roof. If you look at this chart that I just put up, that's a map of the energy reserves of our planet. On the far right corner of the diagram, you see that little ball, it's petroleum. That big ball in the center is sunlight. Our planet is bathed in sunlight. We get more sunlight. We get 1,400 times more sunlight every day than the entire planet consumes in a year. This is an energy-rich planet, but so far, we've only been using coal and petroleum and destroying the planet in the process. Well, the good news is that this is about to change. because this chart shows you the exponential advancement of solar energy. That the prices have been dropping exponentially while the installations have been doubling. This has been happening for the last 50 or 60 years, that the prices keep dropping, the installations keep doubling. Prices keep dropping, the installations keep doubling. Now, there's a lot of disbelief about solar power because it's still a little bit expensive, but it's getting much cheaper. And you have the fossil fuel industry that's trying to stop the advance of solar. But you know, the good news is that we're reaching tipping points. That within the next 5 years or so, the progress of solar energy will be unstoppable. The economics will change to the point that if you're building a new house, or if you have a diesel generator at home, I mean, a lot of your houses have these diesel generators for when electricity goes out. Well, it'll be cheaper for you to put some solar panels on your roof than to have diesel, or even to buy electricity from the electricity company, because the price is dropping exponentially. I wrote this article for the Washington Post in 2014, in which I said that by 2030 or so, the year 2030, energy will be almost free. You know, just like this call that we're doing right now, it's free. I already have an internet plan. I have two internet connections at home. All of you have smartphones with data plans. Thanks to Mukesh Ambani and Jio, the data costs practically nothing. By 2030 or even sooner, energy will be the same, that you will have solar panels and you will be able to now have almost unlimited and almost free clean energy. This is what I wrote is happening exactly as I said it would happen. And it's not only solar, wind energy is also dropping exponentially. And electric storage batteries are also advancing exponentially. The price of batteries is 1/10 of what they were in 2010, and they will halve again by 2025, which means that, you know, a lot of these vehicles that you have all over Bangalore and Delhi and all over India that are polluting the environment, you're going to be throwing them away because electric vehicles will be much cheaper. By 2030 or so, it will not make sense to be running an old fossil fuel consuming car on the road because gasoline will be 10 times more expensive than solar is, than the electric battery-based vehicles are. So we're going to be throwing them away and replacing them with all electric vehicles. The electric revolution is happening whether we like it or not, whether we're ready or not, it's happening. And it's going to have great advantages for humanity. All right, now, let me give an example of another set of technologies that I'm personally involved with. Water. Whenever I come to India, I get sick, despite the fact I drink this bottled water that you have there, and RO water, it's still polluted. Even if it has 1% bacteria, for a person coming from America who's not used to 1% bacteria, we get sick. I get sick all the time when I come to India. The water you have there is filthy polluted. And there's been almost no new technology for the past 40 or 50 years. A lot of, 88% of the infectious disease in the developing world is caused by waterborne viruses. So one of the companies I've been mentoring for the last 10 years built a technology, and this is one scientist, Alfredo Zalesi, and a team of students, essentially, just like you. He got a bunch of students together and recent graduates. And with about 12 people or so, he built a system which sanitizes water by converting it into plasma. Watch this video.
The plasma water sanitation system takes in a continuous flow of contaminated water and injects it under high pressure into a plasma reaction chamber. As pressure drops inside due to acceleration, the liquid stream transforms into a biphasic gas-liquid flow. An electric field is applied to the biphasic flow, transforming it into non-thermal plasma, destroying all virus and bacteria in the water. As velocity decreases, pressure increases, turning the flow back into liquid, which is then released from the chamber, delivering clean, safe, and reliable water in a continuous flow.
This water is 100% clean. not 99% clean like RO and you know the technologies you have in India, 100% clean. Everything living in the water is killed when it's transformed into plasma. So this company is based in Chile, in Santiago, Chile. And it was one scientist and a bunch of students, literally, you know, recent graduates, who built this world-changing technology. So much so that the president of Chile rolled out the first unit in a village in 2016. And then in 2018, they started rolling it out in more villages across Latin America. And then Airbus and Siemens came along and they built small units that could go on airplanes. So this technology was set to take over the world, and then something happened. What was something? The pandemic. So suddenly everything stopped. So Alfredo went back to basics and he said, okay, what else can I do with my technology? He had another generation of students working with him and he came up with another set of ideas saying, okay, you know something? I can do another magical thing while I wait for the pandemic to end. I can solve another of humanity's grand challenges, the problem of food, fertilizer. You know what happened in Sri Lanka with the fertilizer crisis? It wasn't all fertilizers that caused the economic crash of Sri Lanka, but they were trying to go all organic. The trouble was that the technology wasn't there for them to do this. So what is the solution to this? Well, the solution is something called plasma activated water. Do you know how Mother Nature fertilizes this planet? Through lightning, which goes through the air and adds, I mean, so you have lightning that goes through the clouds and you have air, water, and electricity. And what comes on the planet is what's called plasma activated water. This is why when you go to places in India, like in Kerala, there's a lot of lightning, there's a lot of thunder. Land is very fertile. What happens is that when lightning is a force state of matter, plasma. That's the exact same thing that Alfredo had built into his unit. That device, by the way, takes only 1,000 watts of energy. That's less energy than a hairdryer. And it's able to convert water in high throughput into clean water. But what Alfredo discovered was that he could do the same thing to create plasma activated water. That all he had to do was tweak the software and he would develop this, generate this magic called plasma activated water. What does plasma activated water do? It does the same thing that Mother Nature does. That first of all, it adds a molecule to the oxygen. So H2O becomes H2O2, hydrogen peroxide. Hydrogen peroxide is like a vaccine. You know, when you, for COVID, all of you got vaccines. Well, if you add a little bit of hydrogen peroxide to the water that you give to plants, it's like giving them a vaccine. It triggers a defense mechanism and it causes them to defend themselves. So it's a natural pesticide. In the right proportion that Mother Nature does it, it's a pesticide. And then what it does is that it also adds nitrates because the air is what, 78% nitrogen. So when lightning goes through it, it also adds nitrates to the water. So you get fertilizer out of it. And what you end up doing is that you end up creating superfoods by putting plasma activated water on them. So really what you're talking about is distributed green generator. So the same device I just showed you, that plasma water device, now can generate plasma activated water. And with it, we can launch the next green revolution. This is something which was discovered during the pandemic and I've been helping Alfredo now get this tested. So the two largest farms in the United States and Florida have been testing it. They've been testing it with tomatoes and with other types of fruits and vegetables. Anand Mahindra's team wanted it tested on wheat, and Mukesh Ambani's team wanted a few other tests. So they've been running tests in Texas, and the results are like magic. That this water, which costs practically nothing to produce, is now able to remove the need, dramatically reduce the need for pesticides and dramatically reduce the need for fertilizer. We're talking about launching a new green revolution from a technology that was built in Chile. I'm going to be bringing this to India over the next few months. And if everything goes the way I hope, we're going to essentially transform agriculture. So clean water to billions of people, agriculture energy. These are just three examples of the things that are possible. So, you know, I'm going to conclude this part of the lecture over there by telling you that it is possible for all of you now to build world-changing inventions like this. Technologies are making amazing things possible. But, you know, one lesson that I want to conclude, this is my concluding lesson, is that every technology can be used for good and it can be used for evil. That at the same time we're able to create the future of Star Trek, we can create the darkness of Mad Max. Technology can be used for good and it can be used for evil. One of the reasons why, you know, I mean, I'm up late at night. It's my bedtime now. I normally go to bed early and wake up early. The reason I'm speaking to you is because Silicon Valley, I worry that that the students over here are obsessed with making money, that they're using, you know, companies such as Facebook are using technology for evil and taking us to Mad Max. Because we have to make some important decisions with every technology. We have to make sure that every technology can benefit everyone equally. We have to make sure that the rewards of the technology exceed the risks. Every technology has major risks. We have to make sure that the good is better than the bad. They have to make sure that we promote autonomy versus dependence. There are two reading assignments I have for you. And both of these books are available in India. And they're of course a fraction of the price what they call it, cost over here. Driving the Driverless Car walks you through the basics of exponential technologies and teaches you about the ethical issues of advancing technologies. From incremental to exponential teaches you how to build trillion-dollar businesses. It teaches you how you can now learn from Silicon Valley and build billion-dollar businesses. You should read both of these books. They should be mandatory reading for all of you if you want to save the world. All right, with that now, let me turn the lecture back over to Professor Shankar, and we can do Q&A now.
Yeah, thank you very much. That was a very interesting talk, Vivek. There's space for a couple of questions. Would you like to, anyone with any questions? Well, let me begin with a question, Vivek. We do talk about technologies and all the promise that they can hold. When we were looking at technologies back in the 1990s, IBM had come up with Watson, and Watson was supposed to crack healthcare. And not very recently, maybe a couple of years back, that promise came to a halt and they sold off that unit to somebody or the other. People do make projections on what could be happening. While I was in Germany a few years back, they said that 2030 was the time, the last date for the internal combustion engine. And I was all too happy about that, but it looks like I don't see that end in sight. I'm not talking of just the automobiles going out of ICE, but the rest of the industries. What is your take on it as to, you know, the risk of making a prediction that doesn't come through, and when does one stop?
Shankar, this prediction about internal combustion engines, I actually agree with that prediction now. I believe that by 2027 or 2028, all of the major automotive manufacturers, all of them, are going to discontinue internal combustion engines. Why? Because electric vehicles will be cheaper and better and cleaner than those cars are. So they're not going to disappear by 2030, but we will stop buying ICE cars by 2030 at the latest, and even getting them off our roads. So that prediction is actually coming true. And this is why I showed you this video about the robots, because just like with robots, we wrote them off. That, hey, these things are stupid. They're falling apart. The Defense Department wrote them off. But the fact is that they're happening, that exponential technologies can be deceptive, but then they catch us by surprise and amazing things happen. So even with my prediction, when I go back and look at the things I was saying, in some of my predictions, like I said in 2012, that manufacturing will return to the United States by 2020. I was off by 5 years. By 2025, manufacturing will return to the United States. And what China has done with, what China is doing now is accelerating the process because everyone wants to get out of China. American companies, Western companies are rushing to get out of China, and they can now have robots through the work of human beings. So manufacturing will start to return en masse by 2025 to the United States. And this is an opportunity for India because India will be able to provide robotic manufacturing as well. So a lot of these things take a little bit longer than expected, and it takes longer to get from the lab to the field than you expect, but they do happen. Amazing things are happening.
Sure. And looking at the positive and negative uses of technology, given that the US is, you know, your biggest warmongering nation on the planet, you could expect that at some point they will switch from, you know, using men and women on the battlefield to using Atlas, that particular robot that he showed from Boston Dynamics. But isn't there some sort of a vested interest that will still continue sending human beings to war?
In Ukraine, a lot of the victories that Ukraine achieved was through the use of drones, through the Turkish drones in particular, right? You already begin to see these things show up there. As soon as they have these robots that will battle ready, you're going to start seeing robots showing up on the battlefield. So they're coming and they're dangerous. And there's a lot to worry about. I actually wrote a couple of foreign policy articles warning about it, that we need to now have international treaties to prevent this, because they're coming and they're going to be a big threat. Drones are going to, this is something which I've been trying to warn the Indian government as well. I wrote a couple of articles for the Hindustan Times warning about the threat of drones, because you can now build drones, the same drones that were used in Ukraine, you can now start using them for terrorism. And I'm worried that they're going to start bombing cities using drones. We don't have the anti-drone defenses fast enough. So there are a lot of, this is why I worry about technology. And this is why I keep warning about the ethical issues of technology. We have to be very cognizant and stop the misuse of technology.
Sure. There seems to be a question on the chat. Prashant asks, have the capabilities in data storage kept up with the exponential growth of raw data requiring to be stored? Energy efficiency seems to be a big issue.
If you look at the amount of data that Google is now storing, these big companies are storing, and the cloud, and the fact that prices keep dropping, the answer is yes, storage is definitely advancing exponentially. And yes, it's using a lot of energy, as you're seeing with Bitcoin. I mean, Bitcoin is using more energy than most countries do. But it's essentially, our use is increasing faster than some of the other storage technologies being implemented. It's a race, as it happens all the time. But storage is on an exponential path, and soon we'll have local storage devices. So we won't need cloud computing. We'll have edge computing. We'll have local storage that has enough storage for most of the things we do locally. So for robots, for example, instead of being cloud connected, they'll have enough storage locally that they'll be able to make intelligent decisions and do a lot of the work that they do need to do.
Okay. Hi, this is Vijay. I run an robotics, like edutech company in Qatar, and we teach kids on how to build robots. So my question is that with a lot of data popping up on every user, individual users, you can pretty much define a person with the data now. So where do you draw the line, like in which the US like elections was disrupted by data because Facebook and Cambridge Analytica, that scam happened. And in China, they're using data to rate people, in which you have to have a certain rating to have access to a certain one. So do you believe this, yes, data in good way, there is an option, but when it goes to the government or when it is not properly maintained, it becomes an enemy of the society. What do you believe in that?
I worry a lot about data privacy. It's out of control. I mean, the tech industry, China, governments, they're abusing it. Everything is being monitored, and there are no protections. India's been dabbling in it, trying to implement some sensible data policies, but they're bogged down. The European Union is ahead of India and America right now in implementing new data policies. But we are in trouble because we're being monitored, intercepted. And the most evil is happening in China right now, because China is using data to suppress its entire population, that they're watching everything that the people do. It's like Big Brother from the 1984, the dark novel 1984. That's what China has become. And it's terrifying to see what's going on here. So I think data is a human, we own our data, it's a human right. And over the next 5 years or so, we're gonna have to come to grips with it and start protecting it and start destroying the data stores that these companies have gathered.
Hi, sir. you are talking about the evolution of technology. I have a doubt in EV, not in normal space, it's a commercial space. The EV trucks, what is the phase in US? And I'm looking to start in that. But it is difficult to find a single EV truck in particularly for a large distance. What is the phase in US? What is the phase in going around the world in EV trucks?
EV trucks, you're talking about, they're coming. I mean, it's taking 2 or 3 years longer, but within the next 2 or 3 years, it's going to be a no-brainer. You're going to have them rolling out all. I mean, Volvo has been building them, a whole bunch of, even Mahindra has been working on them. It's taking 2 or 3 years longer than it should have, but they're coming. And even the trucks are going to be all electric in the next few years because they're more economical that way. Charging stations are going to be set up because suddenly the market opportunity is going to be there. You know, 2 or 3 years is when we start reaching tipping points for electric vehicles, because the cost of batteries is going to drop by another 20, 30, 40%. And then you're going to have a new generation of batteries, such as, you know, Mukesh Ambani bought Faradion, this British company, to build sodium ion batteries. The sodium ion batteries, even sand batteries, there are all sorts of new battery technologies, graphene-based batteries that are coming. So as soon as those become commercially viable, the cost will drop and the capacity will increase. And suddenly you're going to find that the trickle of electric vehicle becomes a flood, and they start doubling every year. So, and it's not going to be cars, it's going to be trucks, it's going to be airplanes, which will go electric as well, all over the next 5 or 10 years.
Hello, sir. Srinath here. So I had a question about, you know, AR and VR. So what do you think that in the next future, in the next 5, 10 years, do you think, will it evolve to an extent where all the human beings will get adapted to it? Or, you know, it's like a hoax sort of a thing, like, you know, something that's going on with Metaverse in Facebook right now. So they're like investing billions of dollars, like all the major players in the world, right? So what do you think about that?
I think it's going to go, if you look at the progression of smartphones, it's going to be the same as that, except much, much faster. That you're going to have the first generation. We already have a generation of AR, VR headsets, still very expensive, very clunky, not very good. Next year or two, you'll have some amazing technologies coming out. And then you're going to have Apple, probably within 3 years, you're going to have an Apple VR device, which is going to be beautiful. It's very, very expensive. And you're going to find that the rich people start buying these. And then suddenly, within 5 years, you're going to have inexpensive sets. You're going to have eyeglasses that you wear that turn dark. And take us into virtual reality worlds in the next 5 or 10 years. So give it 2 or 3 years, but this metaverse is coming. It's not going to be Facebook that owns it. It's going to be companies all over the world. India is going to participate equally, and India could actually lead in this entire sector, because it's already doing a lot with AR, VR, and it has a lot of the talent necessary to build these technologies.
Yeah. Thank you very much. And it looks like we are out of time now. Excellent insights, Vivek. We will catch up again. And, you know, speaking of such technologies, in 1991, when Tim Berners-Lee wrote the very first web page, nobody knew that it's going to be 1 trillion pages big in these times. I didn't, because I was a graduate student in 1991, and I had the Mosaic browser at that time, and I thought that Netscape was the best invention after that. But yes. Metaverse is going to be a protocol rather than just a universe. You know, pretty soon things are going to have to adapt to that. So that's just the way the technologies go. Things are going to become more accessible. As you mentioned in one of your videos, we could think of having conferences on the surface of the moon, right? So that can also happen. So thank you very much, Mr. Vivek, and we'll keep in touch. Thank you.
All the best.
Thank you.